Hachette Audio presents Palo Alto, A History of California, Capitalism, and the World. Written by Malcolm Harris. Read by Patrick Harrison.
I should be very much pleased if you could find me something good, meaty, on economic conditions in California, of course, at my expense. California is very important for me, because nowhere else has the upheaval most shamelessly caused by capitalist centralization taken place with such speed. Karl Marx, Letter to Friedrich Adolf Zorge, November 5, 1880. Chapter 0.1. Introduction. Palo Alto is nice. The weather is temperate. The people are educated, rich, healthy, innovative. Remnants of a hippie counterculture synthesized with high technology and big finance to produce the spiritually and materially ambitious heart of Silicon Valley. In some circles, the small city, population near 70,000 as of this writing, has acquired the mythical reputation of a postmodern El Dorado, where money flows by the billions from the investors on Sand Hill Road to hundreds of garages where scrappy coders are changing the way we do everything, from driving around to eating food. On per capita terms, the valley ranks with the planet's wealthiest spots, Qatar, Macau, Luxembourg. A few people seem convinced that Palo Alto is, in fact, the center of the world. Leland and Jane Lathrop Stanford gave the town its reason to be, and its name. But they weren't the first to colonize the area, and they didn't invent the words Palo Alto, which means tall tree in Spanish, and refer to a particular specimen. El Palo Alto is a sequoia that got its name from a governor of California, or rather, the Californias. The Spanish expedition of Gaspar de Portola was the first European group to reach the San Francisco Bay Area, and many of the names they assigned to natural features remain. A quarter millennium or so later, nearby Portola Valley is the richest town per capita in the richest country in the world. For 5 days in November of 1769, the expedition camped under a towering tree near what is now San Francisquito Creek. El Palo Alto, now over 1,000 years old, still stands, a straight mile shot from Palo Alto High School, right down the train tracks. Today's settlers find the schools a bigger draw than the foliage. For parents hoping to give their children the best chance at a successful life, the Palo Alto Unified School District is choice. In a society where skills and education are supposed to make the difference, it's hard to make a better tuition-free bet than PAUSD. Even more than the hot job market and the Silicon Valley stock options, the school system is what has driven the median home price up near $3 million at the time of this writing. I was born in Santa Cruz, California, but my mother and father met in Palo Alto as a research assistant and a temp typist, respectively. They moved our family back to town in 1996, and I spent the second half of my childhood on quiet cul-de-sac in the very nice place. My life felt traditionally United States suburban, a lot like what I saw on TV. But every now and then, something else shone through the figurative fence posts at the edge of town. There were signs that, if Palo Alto was normal, it was too normal. Weirdly normal. I attended Ohlone Elementary, named for what we were told was the tribe that used to live on the peninsula. And one day in fourth grade, we had a substitute teacher. Most of the adults in my life were pretty stable as far as I could tell. I wasn't used to their behaving unpredictably. Maybe that's why I was so spooked that day when, instead of following the regularly scheduled curriculum, the substitute sat us down on the carpet and tried to tell us something important. "You live in a bubble," she said, her voice strained and urgent. "The rest of the world isn't like this. Do you know that?" 24 wide-eyed children looked back at her. We did not know that. I don't recall a lot of specific days from that age, but this one stuck with me. Apparently, some of my classmates told their parents about the unscheduled bubble lecture, because when he returned, our regular teacher apologized to us for what happened and reassured us that the bad substitute wouldn't be back, that the district had blacklisted her. If that was supposed to make us disregard what we heard, it had the opposite effect on me. As I grew up, Palo Alto gradually offered its own explanation for why things were the way they were, why some people had big houses and others didn't, why some people lived here and everyone else didn't. They deserved it. Hard work and talent allowed some people to change the world single-handedly, and they earned whatever they got. Sometimes this message was literally written on the walls, like the stories about Hewlett and Packard in the Stanford Engineering Building, printed on a permanent informational display near a water fountain I frequented as a teenager. But it was also the town's implicit underlying ideology from its founding. We all got the message. The suicide started in 2002. That year, a Palo Alto High freshman stepped in front of the Caltrain, the same locomotive line on which Leland Stanford built the town. 13 months later, one of his classmates ended his life the same way. Both picked the Churchill Avenue crossing, right near the school. In 2009, four more students between the ages of 13 and 17 killed themselves at the Meadow Drive crossing near their school, Gun High. Another string of Palo Alto teenagers died by train in 2014 and 2015. These deaths were well publicized, particularly as a social scientific example of the rare double cluster of suicidality, as if it were an unusual astrological phenomenon. The Atlantic magazine ran a cover story on the Silicon Valley suicides, and no investigation of self-destructive teens was complete without a reference to Palo Alto. One thing the coverage missed was that the official tally undercounts the victims by at least half, because it excludes young people who killed themselves after graduation, even when they returned to the tracks to do it. The community experienced not two clusters, but a constant flow of tragic deaths in the 21st century. It continues. A month before I finished this manuscript, a 22-year-old Gun High graduate ended his life on the tracks. As kids, when we talked about the place where we lived, my brother, sister, and I used to make morbid jokes about Sunnydale, the fictional California setting for the TV show Buffy the Vampire Slayer, where perfect weather conceals the portal to hell under the high school. As I got older, I began to think of the idea earnestly. We have a word for idyllic towns where the youth suicide rate is 3 times as high as it's supposed to be. Haunted. Palo Alto is haunted. When I say haunted, I don't mean haunted in the ghost sense, not exactly, or at least not necessarily. We use the word all the time without referring to actual phantoms. We can be haunted by a loss or a traumatic event, or even by that dumb thing we said that one time. Haunting happens when a past action won't go away, won't stay past. But the word usually refers to a relation between the living and the dead. There's an imbalance between the realms, something stuck where it isn't supposed to be. Haunting is homologous with theft, which also involves things being where they shouldn't. But we're not talking about a stolen wallet. It takes more than that to disturb hell. What haunts are the kinds of large historical crimes that, once committed, can never truly be set right. The simplest imbalance between the living and the dead is just that. We are still here, and they're not. When it comes to my classmates, the division feels arbitrary. Some of those who died were depressive, some weren't. A description of the living as well. Anything you could say about them, you could say about us too, except the one. That has haunted me, and I have struggled to find a way to approach it as a writer. There is a whole pile of journalistic investigations of the Palo Alto suicides, as well as a long Centers for Disease Control report, and I found them uniformly unsatisfying in a way that suggests a problem with the medium rather than the reporters. I have no interest in writing a suburban California survival memoir either, and I write about myself like a bad bowler anyway, always headed straight for the gutters of historical context, rather than for the pins of personal revelation. One thing I learned about in Palo Alto was C. Wright Mill's concept of the sociological imagination, which he describes as a tool people can use to understand what is happening in themselves as minute points of the intersections of biography and history within society. Much like the sociological imagination, a haunting pulls together biography and history on the social field.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.